As a folklorist who has spent the last 30 years studying the cultural traditions of my home state, I'm dedicated to documenting and presenting the cultural roots of Alabama. Ride along as I encounter Alabama's folk practices where they occur and meet the people who continue them. I'm Joey Brackner, and this is Journey Proud. This time on Journey Proud, we're coon hunting in northwest Alabama. We'll let the dogs loose and attempt to tree a raccoon while we learn about the importance of this hunting practice in a community where champion dogs are honored in this life and the next. Today we're headed north to Franklin County to meet with the Hatton family, who have graciously agreed to take us coon hunting and help us understand the subtleties of this very popular sport. Unlike other forms of hunting, it's the performance of the coon dog that is the focus.
Frankie.
Joey.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. This is my son, Heath.
Hi, Heath. I appreciate y'all taking the time to let me go coon hunting with you.
We're glad to take you.
And I see you've got your truck all ready to go.
Yeah, we've got our truck and a few things that we use while we're coon hunting.
The dog box, it's all about the dogs, right?
It is. We got to keep them safe.
Well, now what is this?
This is actually a Garmin tracking system. It actually tracks your dogs.
Man, that's sophisticated.
Yeah, it's one of the modern ones now we have. The older ones used to have that we used, say, 20 years ago.
Uh-huh.
They had a...
Oh, wow, it's like a antenna.
You had to fold them out like we used to see on the Wild Kingdom, remember, years ago?
Oh, yeah.
That's actually how these worked. You actually put your collar on the dogs, and you had to fold these out.
Oh, and the collar would be like a transmitter.
The collar would be transmitter, and you'd actually have to hold it up. Say, if you cut the collar on, see, then you get faster and louder as you turned it to it. See how loud it gets? You had to learn to read the gauge to know exactly what the distance was that they was.
But right.
The old ones actually had tree switches in them where if they lean back and went to treeing.
Oh, I hear
it. See where it gets faster?
I hear
so
that.
So if the dogs did get out of hearing, you could actually tell if they was treed or not. The newer ones now, it's actually set up with a GPS system. That once you cut it on and set your collar to it.
Oh, yeah.
And we have two or three different dogs in the system. You just have to go to the collar that you normally put the dog on.
I got you.
And then you set it and get it ready. Like I just did on the map, it actually tells you exactly where the collar is.
I see that.
From the receiver, it'll tell you it actually goes up to, see, it shows right there, it's 4 foot away. It actually show this creek, so I used to when we was using the old type and turn the dogs loose and say, mm-hmm. There is a creek about a quarter of a mile down there. If the dogs treed on the other side of it and say the water was up, we wouldn't know that till we got down there. Then we'd have to come all the way back the truck, go around, go to the bridge and go down the side of it. Well, see, now it shows you the creek, everything it shows you. So before you leave here, they on the other side of the creek, so you'd know to go ahead and do it. So that's how much technology has changed.
That makes the hunt a whole lot more economical for y'all because you'll know whether or not you need to get in your vehicle.
It does.
And I see that you have light, and y'all are already wearing your boots.
You've got to have a light. There's a lot of different types of lights these days, but the 21-volt system that we use, it's got like five switches on it. You can run it on low, and it'll run up to 12 hours, which is all night long. But it's got a higher light beam on it for the bubs, like when you get to the tree where you can find the coon.
Well, the main tool you need is the dog. I hear one in the background. How many dogs are we gonna take tonight?
We'll probably take three. We'll take the young dog. He has a young dog that we leave down here. Most of the young dogs we leave here on my land. Mm-hmm. I have 40 acres here, and I'm sort of off the road, so
right.
The dogs can run freely, and most of the time they'll start treeing on their own. Okay. And once they start treeing on their own, then we put them up.
Heath, what's your dog's name that we're taking?
Brock.
Rock? Okay, great. And then the other dogs?
We're going to go to my brother's.
Okay.
And he's got two dogs that he'll take. It's actually the older dogs, the trained dogs. They actually train. I don't mean they'll train one, but they're supposed to.
Hey, we'll just hope for the best. Is it okay if I just ride on the back?
That's fine.
It's just real close, right?
That's fine. Yes, sir.
Okay,
real close.
Super.
We stop at the dog pen and load Rock. And then Heath and I jump on the back of Frankie's truck to head over to his brother's. Riding this way reminds me of my youth when I would ride in the back of my uncle's truck to go hunting with him and my dad. Frankie's brother Sammy is a serious coon hunter who travels around the country with his dogs to participate in high-profile competition hunts.
Howdy, I'm Joey Brackner.
Sammy
Hatton. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
All right. And you've already got your dogs ready.
Yeah, I just put him in there.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all do a lot of competition hunting.
Yeah.
Tell me about that. How does that work?
Well, you know, like this dog here, he's super state. He's a two-year-old. His brother won the one-year-old last year, his litter mate. He's from Colbert.
Okay.
And you got to go to these little hunts to qualify. You know, you'll go to like a $30 hunt or a $50 hunt. You've got to win $100 to get a ticket to go.
I got you. It's kind of like the playoffs.
Yeah, that's basically what it is. But there's people hunt them every night. They got them every night of the week.
So there's a one-year-old category. What are the categories?
Two-year-old, one-year-old, and a three-year-old.
Okay.
He'll hunt in a two-year-old in Salem, Illinois, September the 25th. I'm taking him up there.
So this is like a national
thing. There'll be dogs all over the United States up there.
Wow.
And then the world hunt, it'll be the same place this October, end of October, I like to think 27th. Both of him and the other dogs going to world hunt.
What kind of prizes when you get up to these regional?
It's $30,000 in the world hunt, and he's hunting for $10,000 in the two-year-old.
My word.
He gets to hunt for both of them.
I guess champion dogs then be worth a lot of money.
Oh, yeah.
What kind of prices do the top dogs bring?
Well, I've seen some bring $20,000 and
$30,000. Oh, my.
The dog that won the Breeder Showcase last year, they sold him for $20,000.
Well, I can see why you want some tracking devices on an expensive dog.
Well, how did you and Frankie get started hunting?
Oh, we've been hunting ever since we was kids. Daddy hunted. I mean, we've been hunting a long time.
Right.
Long time.
Right.
We've been in competition.
And you never got tired of it?
Nah. Well, all of our old dogs died, see. This dog here, I bought him. Me and another fella bought this dog and the dog that's coming. We bought them last year. These boys want to start back hunting some, so I just went and bought some pretty good ones, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Because we ain't got none of our old stock left. None of them, all of them. Mm-hmm. You know, in the 90s and 80s when they was born.
Can you go coon hunting pretty much all year round?
Yeah, as long as you don't kill them.
Okay.
And season opens September 1st tomorrow.
Okay.
Goes through February 28th.
Okay.
Or 29th.
But a lot of times when you go coon hunting, even if it is in season, you don't bother to kill them,
no,
right?
No, well, you know, you want to have a good kill season on the dog if you're running him hard in the summer. And then, like, after the world hunt, after October, don't nobody really hunt much. And, you know, when the deer hunter starts, you know, it's just a lot of people quit. A lot of them do.
Well, we're going to go to the memorial celebration at the Coon Dog Cemetery. Does your family have any dogs buried over there?
Yeah, got two.
Mm-hmm. Were they your dogs?
Well, they're mine, Frankie's. Frankie. Okay. Okay. Mine, he. We both hunted them.
Okay. What are the different breeds of coon dogs that are available?
I got walkers. You got blue ticks, English, red bone, black and tan. Got a plod hound, they call a plod hound.
Mm-hmm.
Now they got some they call crossbreed, be a walker and a blue dog. You know, they cross them up.
Right.
And that's mainly in PKC. That's a professional kennel club. It's out of Evansville, Indiana.
Okay.
You know, that's where that club and the other one's in Kalamazoo, Michigan. That's the United Kennel Club.
Okay.
And that's the only two I usually even hunt. I don't hunt none of the rest of them, but the PKC one is the one that does the money. That's the one you hunt for money.
Yeah.
In UKC, it's a point system, you know. Right. You got to have so many points to be a night champion, and got to win so many night champions to be a grand night.
Yeah.
You know, you win a little, but you lose a bunch of money because you buy motels, you know, time you add it up, you don't win nothing.
But you have a good time.
That's all it is, just have a good time.
Now, did you tell us the name of your dog yet? I can't remember.
No, that's Spook.
Spook?
Yeah, Spook.
And the dog we're waiting on, what's his name?
Slick.
Slick. Spook, yeah. Slick, and Rock. Well, we ought to have some success with names like that.
Yeah, we ought to do something.
Slick and his owners show up as darkness falls, and we all proceed over to the nearby pasture to park adjacent to the woods. The men equip themselves with lights, and the dogs are brought out and taken to the tree line, where we hope they'll catch a scent. And sure enough, by the time we take a few steps, the dogs are straining at the leash. As soon as they begin baying, they're released and the hunt is on.
Now normally we just sit and talk to the dogs track. They're usually track when they get on the creek down there, close to the creek.
What are they saying?
That's the puppy there. That's one of the other dogs.
You can tell the dogs apart by their barks.
Yeah, it's just like me and you talking. Once I hear your voice, after about three times you call me on the phone, I know who you are.
So the one that hit the track, who's that?
That was Slick.
Slick?
That's Slick. See, there'll be a lot of musky dines up and down through here, up from this creek. A lot of times they'll bump where they've been playing around in them musky dines. See how this dog, he's on the creek. We can actually start towards them, y'all. They are actually already treed.
We've already treed one, okay.
Well, that didn't take long.
The dogs have all split up, all three dogs. And this dog treed up this oak tree, this pin oak. And we have one dog down here in front of us trailing, which is Spook. And we have the young dog, which is Rock. He's to the right of us. He's about 100 yards down there. And now they're back trailing again.
We get to the first dog and search the canopy for evidence of a treed raccoon. With the late summer foliage, seeing anything up in the branches proves very difficult.
To see them sometimes,
yeah,
isn't it?
It's a thick this time of year.
Yeah.
Unless they look right at you with their eyes glowing, it's hard to see them. I notice there's still acorns on the ground where the coons are still eating acorns. If you can find an opening.
I've heard some coon hunters talk about dogs that will lie.
Yeah.
What do they mean when they say that?
Trees up there ain't nothing else.
Okay.
But I mean, a lot of dogs, like that old big dog there, he's a tree dog.
Uh-huh.
You know, he trees coons, but no, he'll miss them some.
Right.
And a lot of people say that's lying. But when you're in these big woods, you can't really correct him for it.
Right.
But if he falls tree on a little old snag, ain't nothing up there, you got to correct him.
Right.
You know, you'll correct him, slap him around a little bit, tell him to go on.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he knows. I mean, they know when
speak
they do.
Speak sternly to him.
But
yeah.
Usually the way he treat on that tree, he's usually got the coon.
Gotcha.
I mean, he's won several hunts. This boy here's won like 7 out of 10 with him. Mm. And usually when he does that by himself, he's got the coon.
This one, how far away you think that is?
I don't know. I ain't got my garment on me. He's a long way.
We get quiet and wait in the heat for the next tree.
So when you're not in hunting season, how do the dog? Is this a reward enough for the dogs?
Yeah,
just a tree?
Just pet him on the head, reward him, and turn him off the tree and send him again.
Gotcha.
And the dogs are actually going down the creek.
So you're hearing them going down the creek bed.
Yeah. I see, that's the Spook dog. That's the 2-year-old dog is we're going to hunt at the Super Stakes.
Has he treed yet?
No, he's trailing.
This is trailing.
He's trailing. Then it's just a waiting game to listen and see what happens.
You want to sit down on this log?
Yeah, we can
sit down. The other guys? Maybe it won't break.
Maybe it won't. We can all sit down and sit and listen. We all got good bug spray all over us.
That's right.
We may have to ease on down to keep in hearing's the only thing.
What do you do? I really don't know how to work it.
So, how do you get your dogs back?
Go get them.
When they tree.
Just go to them.
Most time you teach them not to come back till they tree. Now, if you turn one loose and he don't strike anything in 30 minutes, 45 minutes, that's okay to come back. You know, if they can't find a coon.
I see.
Most of the time, them two dogs there, once you turn them loose, they're not coming back till they get treed somewhere.
You think Rock's gonna be with the other dogs?
Oh, no.
They're all three real close. I hear all three up there.
Well, boys, y'all ready to walk?
Most of a coon hunt is walking and following the dogs after they tree the coon. We have to step carefully, avoiding obstacles like fallen logs, fences, and briar patches. It's good exercise, and the crew and I wish we had more suitable hunting clothes.
Other duties is required.
But unlike the crew, I thought to wear my paratrooper boots. Nevertheless, our hosts insist on carrying us all across the creek.
We're gonna make Joey swim, right?
I'm gonna wait. I got these old.
We're going. Whoa.
All right. The guys insisted, because they had waders on, or coon hunting boots that were waterproof, that they would carry us across the spring creek there. And so they did, and they did a great job. We're getting really close now.
And it sounds like all three dogs are together.
Well, that's convenient.
That's convenient. We could
end our hunt here if we wanted to.
Yeah.
With all three dogs on one tree, hopes are high that we'll finally see a coon.
Pretty treat it.
I ain't seen nothing. He's up a cedar tree.
Though the dogs remain convinced, we still don't see a raccoon. So as hot as it is, and with the dogs mostly together, Sammy gives them an opportunity to cool down. And we're all getting really tired.
I've heard you talking about the dogs getting hot and everything, and it's obviously a concern, because they're working really hard when they're treeing coons, right?
Yeah. So you see how hot it is.
Well, it's hot and humid right
Well, tonight. Some dogs are different. Like this big dog here, he'll go to breaking down when it gets hot. Wintertime, he's a whole different dog.
Mm-hmm.
But when it gets hot weather, he'll go to breaking down. And you know, he'll go to missing, sitting there. He'll be treeing, he'll shut up. But what he's doing, he's getting hot.
Yeah. Well, I was noticing y'all were making sure they had plenty of water.
Yeah, I mean, I usually get them water. You know, you can't really do that in a hunt, but you know, pleasure hunting, you do it. But
right.
Usually when it's hot, I won't go.
Right.
Because you know, with that young dog, the two-year-old dog, Spook, he don't get hot like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's younger, he's a different kind of dog.
Okay. Well now, we've got two of the dogs, so we gotta get the third dog, right?
Yeah.
So we gotta wait for that dog to tree,
yeah.
Right? Okay.
But you don't have to. I mean, you know, it's one of them things, like when you pleasure hunt, you know,
mm-hmm.
sometimes I'll leave him a little while and then come back, you know, if he still ain't tree.
I
can catch him, I'll catch him.
Okay.
But usually he's one of them that you know he ain't gonna let you catch him because he knows he ain't done what he's supposed to do.
Right.
As we wait for the last dog to tree, he keeps getting farther and farther away.
Spook is 743 yards.
He's actually opposite of where we was in the truck. He's on the other side of the truck.
835 now.
All right, Frankie, so what's happening now?
Right now the dogs are trailing, and the area they're in right now, it's, I guess you could say, semi-cut over timber and rough. That's the reason you hear them doing some off-barking. It's hard for them to get through.
Probably too rough for a TV crew to get into, right?
Yeah. We may have to cut short.
Okay.
We'll go to them once they tree, which sometimes they have come back this way.
Okay.
Down the creek and tree closer to us, but right now they're trying to get him out of that rough stuff.
Well, I guess we'll just head on back to the vehicles now.
That sounds like a good thing to me.
All righty.
We'll get some water.
Okay, sounds like a good plan.
That sounds good to me.
Sammy lets us off the hook by volunteering to round up the last dog. We say our goodbyes to the other fellas and begin our trek through the woods back to the truck. Though it may have seemed unsuccessful, our hunt was great fun, and we learned a lot about the bond between hunters and their dogs.
Well, Frankie, I appreciate it. I appreciate you and Sammy and all the guys spending your evening with us.
We appreciate it. Enjoy the company.
And I'm really looking forward to the Coon Dog Memorial Labor Day celebration tomorrow.
It'll be tomorrow starting at 10.
And we'll see y'all, and we're going to hit the road and get some rest and be up bright and early and see y'all out there at the cemetery.
I'll see y'all then. Y'all be careful.
Okay. All righty.
Today's the annual Labor Day celebration at the Key Underwood Coon Dog Cemetery, located in the Freedom Hills of Colbert County. This little two-lane road is packed with cars and trucks from all over. Janice Williams, one of the friends of the Coon Dog Cemetery, takes a moment to talk to us.
Janice, thank you so much for inviting us to the celebration, Labor Day celebration, at the Coon Dog Cemetery. First off, how did the Coon Dog Cemetery get established?
In 1937, Key Underwood had a coon dog named Troop. And Troop was 15 years old. And this place right here was called Sugar Creek Camp. This is where all of Key Underwood and his friends coon hunted.
I got you.
So he asked all of his buddies, coon hunting buddies, if he could bury Troop up here because this is where he had the best memories of him. And they said yes. So that's how it got started. Troop was buried, and Raymond Wheeler, a former sheriff of Colbert County, and this is a man's name, Wilma Prater.
Okay.
Those are the two that came with Key to bury Troop.
I see.
And they buried him in a cotton pick sack.
Okay.
And then, like I said, other coon hunters buried their dogs up here, and how it was, I don't even know if it was a celebration, but since he was buried on Labor Day,
mm-hmm.
they started coming up here on Labor Day, and...
Kind of like a decoration day.
Yeah, kind of like, but they just the old coon hunters got together and talked about coon hunting together and who had the better dog, and... As time went on, you know, they'd say, well, my dog's buried over there, and he beat your dog one night. And
how many dogs do you think are buried out here now?
I know.
You know.
310.
310. That is incredible. One question about decoration. I see coins on the dogs' graves. What's that about?
It started with Benjamin Franklin's burial. To be honest, I had to Google it.
Benjamin Franklin the dog.
No, Benjamin Franklin.
Oh, I see. So it's borrowed. So it's borrowed from a human burial decoration, and now they do that on the dogs.
And
okay.
We can't take credit for it.
Yeah, I've seen that before, but I was wondering if it had something to do with dogs being money in a tournament or something like that.
Our determination of it is that you are leaving part of yourself at the cemetery.
Yeah.
We have monuments that that
right.
One, the oldest monument, if you'll look around, it's covered in pennies.
Mm-hmm.
The newer monument's got a few on top.
Gotcha.
And we just say if you put it on the monument, you're leaving a part of yourself at the cemetery, mm-hmm. and if you leave it on a tombstone, mm-hmm. that dog mm-hmm. kind of touched you in some way.
Yeah. Let me ask you this on a totally different subject. I hear there's some really good barbecue here.
Oh, yes. I have a ticket for y'all.
Bless your heart.
So every one of y'all can have a plate of
because if we do nothing else on Journey Proud, we eat. And we love to eat, and we try to eat the best food wherever we go.
We get in line to claim our barbecue plates, enjoying friendly conversation and listening to good music. The festival program also includes local politicians, buck dancing, a Biggest Liars contest, craft booths, and the parading of coon dogs. The community atmosphere of like-minded folks is lively and fun, belying the fact that we're in a cemetery.
Someday we'll meet again, sweetheart. We'll meet.
Some people come for the music, some for the barbecue, but many come to pay homage to their old friends. The tended space of the Coon Dog Cemetery is a testament to the deep regard afforded these dogs by their owners. These animals, who bring so much pleasure to the hunters of Northwest Alabama, are given a ritual respect usually only granted for our fellow human beings. The monuments, the grave offerings, the epitaphs, and the manicured landscape are a window into the world of the coon hunter and his faithful companion.